Let's read a paper together. The paper I want to read with you today is called Software Processes or Software 2. It was presented at the International Conference of Software Engineering in 1987 and is considered one of the classic seminal papers in the field. It's written by Leon Osterweil, who is a professor at the University of Colorado at Boulder. Let's get right into it. The goal of this paper is to look at the process by which software is written and then ask the question of whether that process itself can be rigorously specified much in the same way as software itself. So what is a process? The author's definition of a process is anything that is systematically specified, a systematic approach to the creation of a product or accomplishment of some task. Now, when we talk about processes, it's important to differentiate the process itself from the description of a process. The process is a dynamic instantiation of a process description. A process description is a specification of how the job is done, much in the same way as a program is a static thing which you write down, but when you execute it, it becomes a dynamic thing. This is something that Dijkstra talks about, where he says that computer programs are static entities and are much easier for human minds to comprehend, while program executions are dynamic and much harder to reason about. That's one of the big advantages of reasoning with the static description. Now, back when software engineering as a field was first conceived, the goal of the entire field was to make it so that software engineering is much the same as producing goods in a factory, kind of like an assembly line, and that it would be very controlled and very rigorous. Now, we all know that didn't really work out, and software engineering is a very human intensive field. It's not like an assembly line at all. And that's because software artifacts are so complex, they're so large, so difficult to grasp. And the author is saying that if we had a rigorous and concrete description of the process by which software is produced, we would have an easier time understanding the software itself and making it better. And this brings us to the central point of this paper. The central point of this paper is to create software process descriptions and then make these descriptions rigorous, which means that these processes are thought of as instantiations of the process descriptions. In other words, software processes are treated as software itself. Put another way, we want to describe software processes by programming them in the same way that we program computer applications. And the author calls this thing process programming. And he wants to make this the central activity of software engineering. So next, the author goes into kind of a simple example of what part of a software process would look like. This will be familiar to anyone who has written and executed automated unit tests. So this function over here is just a rigorous specification of how to execute unit tests and when to declare the software under test. Okay, it's fairly straightforward, but this is a more formal specification of what we all do when we unit test software. Okay, so if we took this approach and treated software processes as software, what are the advantages of doing that? The biggest advantage is that we evolve the process itself much in the same way as we evolve software. Because software is so large, so complex, and it's intangible and hard to reason about, we really could use a detailed and formal description of what the process that makes software itself is. The second advantage of making a process software is reuse. Just like we can build libraries of software, we can build libraries of software processes and reuse them. And then this is one of the biggest advantages, which is that a rigorously specified process description becomes an effective communication mechanism. Just as code is a rigorous, unambiguous means of communication between programmers, so it is with software processes that are specified like software. They can be automatically analyzed, compiled, and interpreted by computers just like code. And this brings us back to the initial vision, the initial dream of making software engineering a rigorous and factory-like activity. With this, we can think of software objects as variables or instances of types. And the tools themselves are thought of as operators which transform software objects. Now, humans have certain well-defined roles in creating these software objects, but their overall behavior is controlled by a rigorously specified process. Now, reading this, it might sound like the role of the humans is diminished, but it's not really so, because the programmer still has a central role. There are many high-level tasks that remain unspecified by the process, and this is where human judgment and human ingenuity comes in the act of writing software. Another really big advantage of specifying software processes is that, again, much like code, the processes themselves can undergo testing and evaluation. Now, the paper so far makes the case for treating software processes as software itself, but in terms of implementation, all this depends upon there being a suitable language for specifying software processes. And now the author turns to what the properties of such a language might be. Now, unfortunately, in this paper, the author leaves this as an open research question. But if you follow up on other papers by Leon Osterweil, you'll see that he, along with his research group, has designed process languages for specifying things like this. Okay, so to wrap up, to conclude, the author in this paper says that we should consider software processes as first-class programs. So he suggests that the notion of a process program, which is an object which, just like a program, has been created by a development process, should become the key focus of software engineering practice. All right, thanks for watching and reading together. See you next time.